You're on your way to work, driving, enjoying the freedom and flexibility your car provides you. But then, bam! Traffic jam. You inch forward on a congested four-lane road for a good 20 minutes, thinking about how the problem of traffic could be solved. Well, of course, by adding more lanes. If the road is full, you widen the road. Simple, common sense. The city leadership agrees. The road is widened to 6 lanes, and for a few weeks or months traffic flows better, but then, bam, traffic jam again. The road is widened again, this time to 8 lanes, and for a few weeks or months traffic flows better, but then, bam, traffic jam yet again. What on earth is going on? How come the road always fills up, regardless of how many lanes we add? This phenomenon is called induced demand, first observed in the US in the 1930s, and our politicians have been pretending it doesn't exist ever since. Let's take this four-lane road connecting the suburb with the city center. People in that suburb can either take the bike, the train, or the bus to the city, or they can drive. And many do, thus the road is clogged. The slowness of car traffic motivates people to seek alternatives though, like the bike, the bus, or the train. Once the road is widened to 8 lanes, people find that driving is faster now, and people keep switching to their cars to take advantage of this until the road fills up again and car traffic becomes slow and the vicious cycle starts anew. Okay, so why don't we try building so much road capacity that it will never be full? Wouldn't that solve traffic? No. Especially around large cities, there simply isn't enough physical space to build enough lanes to accommodate every potential driver. For example, the Katy Freeway in Texas, widened to now 26 lanes, still gets clogged up. We will not solve traffic by widening roads, just like we won't solve obesity by loosening our belts. By widening the road, instead of solving traffic, you only get to choose how many lanes of traffic jam you want. So what is the solution to traffic? Easy. Turns out induced demand also works in reverse. The less capacity a road has, the more people opt for alternatives. If lane reductions are coupled with investments into bike lanes and public transit, bam! Suddenly traffic gets a lot less severe. Less being late from work, less finite life wasted standing bumper to bumper, less noise, less pollution, and safer adjacent streets for children and pets. Take a look at this iconic picture of the Katy Freeway. Assuming an average US car occupancy of 1.5 per vehicle, every single person in this picture would fit inside two of these shuttler double-decker commuter trains. I know, because I counted. Now tell me, as a taxpayer, would you rather pay for the maintenance of a 2-track rail line or 26 lanes of road? Answers on a postcard. Especially if you're watching this from the US, next time someone tells you public transit is communism or something, remember, as a European taxpayer, I pay for this. As an American taxpayer, you pay for this. As the saying goes, a developed country is not where everyone drives a car. It's where nobody needs a car to get around.